Welcome to Digital Asset News, to get top stories in cryptocurrency digital assets and break them down to bite-sized pieces. Today, we've got some positive yet concerning reports. First up, 65% of traders on PayPal ready to use Bitcoin to pay for goods and services. And this is both great news and frightening if it was actually true. Also, Bitcoin gets 600,000 hits on the 7 trillion assets under management BlackRock website. But the real story is why they were actually tracking this. And last, we'll do a quick follow-up on the Bitcoin miners getting shut off as far as the power supply in China and how that has affected the hash rate of the Bitcoin network. Now we'll get into all that, but first, take a look what's going on in the market. So quickly, it is December 3rd, 9 o'clock a.m. in the morning, and everything's up, so it's looking pretty good. Bitcoin's at 19.3, maybe it's 19.4, maybe 20K the end of the week. Who knows? Ethereum's above 600, and Ethereum 2.0 has been launched, and I don't see or haven't heard of any hiccups or problems, so that is a good thing. XRP is at 62 cents. Congratulations, XRP Army. Looks like it's going up again, so maybe it'll hit a dollar at some point. Who knows? Tether's rocking around 19 and a half billion for the market cap. Litecoin, I tweeted this out today. I want to congratulate all the Litecoin holders. I sold this a long time ago. And if you have held this for this much time, I mean, tip of the hat to you. Not even the founder could actually hold it that long. Charlie sold his a long time ago, and there was a reason for that. But again, all you Litecoin holders, congratulations. Chainlink's up almost at $14. And I keep seeing this like Zeus Capital nonsense on Twitter. And they're always talking about a fraud and a scam and blah, blah, blah. But I got to tell you, every time I see that ad from Zeus, I'm like, oh, that means Chainlink's going to pump. And here we are, 1.7. Bitcoin Cash, 0.2. Polkadot, up. Wow, Polkadot's almost going to hit $6. Pretty great. Cardano, 5%. I like that. Update on the Cardano staking pool. We are still going through the process. Let me tell you, it is very difficult. It's not easy whatsoever. There's a lot of things that have to be put in place, a lot of monitoring, a lot of different just everything has to be done. It has to be done in a very certain specific way and set up the right way the first time. I am not a person that just leaves things up to chance and just says, oh yeah, it's good enough. It has to be a certain way. And I'll let everybody know when it's completed. Binance Coin, rounding out the top 10 spots. So looking out pretty good, nothing really fantastic moving out there. There was a pretty big pump, I think, for VeChain. It's almost gonna hit up to 2 cents, that's pretty great. And then as always, I wanna take a look at how everything is comparing to Bitcoin. Of course, if you're comparing everything to Bitcoin, you wanna know if your investment, if you would've been just better just to invest in Bitcoin. Well, Ethereum's up 1%, that's pretty good. 2.7 for Polkadot, 2.8 for Cardano, hey, not too bad. And 6.9 for NEM. NEM has just been pumping radically, so good for that. 13% for VeChain, and so on and so forth. The more you get out of the top 100, the more you see more of these gains, like Elrond. What else is up there? 6.5 for Band, 9.3 for Curve DAO token, and off you go. The real question is finding those gems, and that's not my game. All right, let's jump into today's top stories. So first up, this is good and bad, and I'll explain a bit. So 65% of traders on PayPal are ready to use Bitcoin to pay for goods and services. And so what's happening here is that there was a survey put out by Mizuho Securities, and it was a very small sample, 380 PayPal users, but it gives you an overall feel of what is going on with the rest of their 346 million active users, I guess. I don't know. That's just how surveys work, but whatever. 17% of the respondents said they have already traded Bitcoin via their PayPal accounts since the firm started offering crypto in October. And as a reminder, it was supposed to be only a small rollout, and then Q1 2021 was going to be the big one. But there was so much demand, they just said, just give it all to them because it's going to be huge. Of these, the majority are the ones who showed readiness to utilize Bitcoin for purchases. The finding is significant to the extent that it bolsters Bitcoin's credentials as a viable means of payment, something that Bitcoin opponents have routinely used to discredit the digital asset. So there's a lot to break down here. First up, when they talk about these people who are ready to use this for payments, that's a bad idea. Because when you start to use Bitcoin for payments, I mean, that's great. I mean, it keeps the whole narrative of a cryptocurrency as far as Bitcoin, but it is bad for tax purposes. And this is the same thing that people were telling me when I did a video which talked about, it was an open letter to PayPal users. And a couple of people said, hey, you didn't mention the fact that every transaction that you do, as far as like Bitcoin, to pay for goods and services, is a taxable event. So you have to keep a record of all of that. And because of that fact, I was actually able to go back and put that into the video that I have hosted over at danteacherscrypto.com. And I talk about what is a taxable event and a non-taxable event. If you want to sign up for danteacherscrypto.com, there's a link in the description. It's a 100% free website. Simplifies everything. Very simple, super easy, and gives you some pretty good advice, I think. So when we talk about these things that are actually taxable, this is not something that is really well known. And right now, since it's not being offered until Q1 of 2021, PayPal really hasn't talked about it. Now, I assume that they are going to have some kind of app or some type of monitoring system so people don't get, you know, screwed in, you know, later on when they're doing their taxes, because whatever you do through PayPal, I know for 100% fact that it's going to go right to the government as far as a 1099. So they're going to know all your transactions that you're doing, and you better pay those taxes, because if not, there's going to be a nice little letter coming to you saying you owe us X, Y, and Z. So next I want to talk about this, where it says here, something that Bitcoin opponents have routinely used to discredit the digital asset, that it's not a good means of payment. They're right. It's not a good means of payment. And we're talking about taxes, that's one thing. And you can not get around, but you can monitor that and, you know, have apps and they can, you know, check you and record all that stuff. But the big thing is that, and this is a big thing, and why it's actually not even a big thing later on, I'll tell you why, that if everybody on PayPal starts to use Bitcoin, Bitcoin Cash, Ethereum, or Litecoin for transactions, all 346 million users of them, we'd have a huge problem. We'd have a huge problem, and things would go off the rails. I'm going to tell you why. This is from YCharts. These are the Bitcoin average transactions fees, or BATF. And if you can see what happened here, this is 2017. Everything was cool until it's not. And you're going to get like 27 cents in 2016, 18 cents back in, you know, however we go, 15, 73 cents. But if you take a look at when the craziness that happened, which was December 23rd, 2017, it was $55 to send a transaction with Bitcoin. So if you're trying to send $25, there's no point in that. And this is all historical data. You can all look it up. And this is what it was, I remember. And not only was it super expensive, it was super slow because there were so many transactions. So Bitcoin can't do that. Now, people will talk about the second layer solutions. Oh, they got Lightning Network and da-da-da. Well, guess what? Still not really working that hot. And that's just how it is. So right now, and this is just averages, okay? Just averages over time. You're looking at December 2nd around... it says 7:30, but I don't think it's that high. I think it just depends on how congested the network is and everything else. So it could be lower. But I mean, if you're just over here, and that was in what was still a parabolic bull run, it was a little crazy. But what do you think is going to happen when you have 346 million people and like 65% of those are like, hey, I want to use it for transactions? You're going to see this go all the way up here, and you're going to see people say, what the heck? I can't. It takes me a couple days to send Bitcoin. I thought this was supposed to be super fast. Well, now you know. But here's why it doesn't matter. And the reason is because of what was stated in this article and been stated in numerous articles, and that is that PayPal plans to use fiat as an intermediary when users make payments to merchants in Bitcoin. So when you are purchasing Bitcoin, you're not purchasing Bitcoin, you're purchasing paper Bitcoin. And they are scooping that up through their partner at Paxos and their exchange. So like me as a vendor, I'm not going to get Bitcoin when people transact in Bitcoin. I'm going to get dollars. That's it, fiat. So when we talk about like an actual payment system, they're not going to be using Bitcoin as a payment system. They're not going to use Bitcoin Cash or Ethereum or Litecoin. It's just going to be on paper, essentially. And what they're going to give me is paper. That's it. So they're going to buy a ton of Bitcoin, and they're buying a ton. We'll get into that in a second. But to see this as an actual currency, and it's actually motive of transactions, it's not going to do that. And then what I fear is that people are going to come back and be like, oh, well, this is great because now Bitcoin can be used as a transaction. And then they're going to go and try to do that on a exchange or their Nano Ledger, if they get that far. And they'd be like, why? Wow, why is it so slow? What's going on? I don't understand. It's so much better at PayPal. They don't understand. It's not going through PayPal like that. It's going just as fiat. So I think people will be uninformed and they'll be blissfully happy to be ignorant about what is going on. And that's one of the reasons why I created Dan Teaches Crypto, to help people understand why it's important to custody your own crypto and digital assets. And that's why I made this. It is the first video in the first module. And again, there's going to be a lot of people who are like, I don't care. I don't want to do that. And that's fine. For those people, do whatever you want to. It's a free world. And I salute you. At least you're here. I'm happy for you. But for the ones that want to know more, want to understand that, why decentralization is a far superior option, that's why I created the website. So go ahead and check that out at the very end. And then moving down to finish up, it states PayPal bought or is buying up to 70% of all the newly minted Bitcoin since the payments giant started offering crypto in October. So between them and the Cash App or Square, they're buying more than 100% of all the newly issued virgin Bitcoin. And that's on top of everything else that just the retail person, the institutions that are actually trying to get into it. And of course, with that, I mean Grayscale. So there's a big competition. I think there's going to be a big supply crunch coming up soon. I'm surprised the price hasn't broke past 20K already, but it is what it is. So that is that portion. Now to move on, I need to just to clarify some things and verify some things. So I invited Sheehan Chandrasekara. He is a crypto CPA, and he's going to let us in and just to verify something we're talking about. Also, I need him to answer a couple of questions that I've been getting a lot of, which one of those is, can I just take out a loan on my cryptocurrency to minimize or totally avoid taxes? So let's get Sheehan in here in the office and he'll answer all those questions. All right, everybody. So the question always is, and this all comes on the PayPal article that we just talked about, for transactions, are we going to be taxed? And, you know, I told you my opinion, but it's best to get an expert. And that is why I invited Sheehan Chandrasekara to come on. Sheehan, thanks for coming on to answer this question. Before we start, just give like a for people who don't know you, tell us a little about yourself and then we'll get to that question.
Yeah, sure. So I'm a CPA. You can follow me on Twitter at TheCryptoCPA. Coming from public accounting background, I'm with a company called CoinTracker, which helps, you know, calculate crypto taxes. But yeah, I mean, if you have any questions, reach out to me. I get a lot of questions and happy to answer and very active on Twitter.
Perfect. I'll link Sheehan's Twitter handle and also the company he works for and then works with, and we'll go from there. So Sheehan, that is the question right now. So as people go into PayPal and they're using Bitcoin Cash, Ethereum, and Litecoin, and they're starting to do transactions onto the merchants like myself, what happens as far as like a trans, or as far as a taxable event?
Yeah, it's a good question. So every time you spend cryptocurrency, because it's treated as a property as opposed to a currency, at least in the, you know, in the eyes of the IRS, that triggers a taxable event. So, which is kind of bad because it kind of, it's bad, meaning like, you know, every time you spend something, there's a taxable event and you don't want that.
That's
what we had to deal with, unfortunately, until the laws change one day.
Okay, so it sounds to me, just to make sure, so every time these guys spend something, it's going to be a somewhat of a taxable event. It's okay if you're like I have thought about buying Bitcoin really fast and then, you know, spending it really fast, which I think would be crazy. Or as opposed to like somebody like me who's invested like 3-4 years and I take that Bitcoin from a long time ago and then start to transact.
Yeah, correct. I mean, at the same time, I just don't understand, like, why would anybody spend Bitcoin to buy, like, you know, day-to-day stuff? Mm-hmm. I think the PayPal story, like, it's good for creating vanity, you know, in this space. But if you're in the right mind, like, you wouldn't be spending, you know, Bitcoin to buy stuff. So I would say if you really need to use a cryptocurrency, like, you know, transact, you know, use a stable currency. So you're not losing out, or there's no tax implications.
Makes sense. And I guess I will retract what I just said, because my Bitcoin that I purchased years ago, I can't put that on the PayPal network because you can't move cryptocurrency between PayPal. It's all paper Bitcoin, paper eCash, and all that stuff. All right. Thanks, Sheehan. So that answers that. Here's the big question. And I think this is the most confusing thing. I get this a lot. And the question is,
well, I don't want to deal with IRAs. I don't want to deal with anything else. What I'm going to do is when the bull run comes, I'm going to take out a loan. And with that loan, I'm going to pay off everything. And that's the way I won't have to pay taxes, because you don't have to pay taxes on loans. However, you have to pay back the loans at some point. So Sheehan, how would that work out? We don't want to avoid taxes or, you know, like be a tax dodger, because no one wants to be that guy or that gal. But how can we minimize taxes? And is this even a possible type of thing we could potentially do?
Yeah, yeah. There's no easy yes and no answer. I guess for me, there are two types of loans. You know, you have your appreciator, you know, Bitcoin or whatever cryptocurrency, you just give it to some party, and then you get USD as a loan proceed. So that type of, you know, loan structure is pretty clear. But what complicates is that, you know, you put your Bitcoin with another party, and as loan proceeds, you're getting another type of cryptocurrency. Then the question is, when you spend that second cryptocurrency which you received as proceeds, what's the cost basis for that? Do we assign a zero cost basis, or do we assign a cost basis equivalent to the fair market value of that second cryptocurrency you received? But it doesn't make any sense because you didn't actually pay for it. Again, I might be a little confusing, but think about the situation from the IRS point of view. Like, why would the IRS allow you to put your appreciated Bitcoin? Let's take an example. You got into Bitcoin when it was like 10 bucks, and now you're sitting on, like, let's say $1 million of Bitcoin. So you are essentially putting that $1 million worth of Bitcoin to some third party, and you are creating liquidity without triggering a taxable event.
Right.
Now, think about how the IRS would see it. So I've actually asked about this question from the IRS. You know, they're still catching up. They're still trying to figure out the laws around, you know, airdrops and et cetera. They haven't even thought about DeFi space yet, but that's where it is today. So it is doable. I think the practical approach is to kind of, you know, because there's lack of guidance, you know, just treat it as a non-taxable event. But there's a huge exposure for you when it comes to tax, especially if you're sitting on a large amount of unrealized gains and you keep taking loans and keep accessing liquidity without ever paying taxes. So it won't work in the eyes of the IRS in the long run.
In the long run, I think you can keep taking loans and loans and loans, but that would be detrimental to yourself as time goes on, because at some point you have to pay all this stuff back with the percentage of whatever it is. I think that would be the big issue for me. And then some people have said in the comments, like, well, what I'll just do is I'll just, like I said, like, I will take out a loan for Bitcoin or Ethereum, whatever else it is, and then I'll just pay it back in USDT or Tether or whatever else. But again, taxable events are when you cash out your cryptocurrency, as I assume, as I see it. Also, a taxable event is when you go from cryptocurrency to cryptocurrency, Bitcoin to Ethereum, Ethereum to USDT or Tether or whatever else. And then when you're paying for goods and services. Because the next thing I get is, well, I'm not going to even pay taxes because in the future, everything will just be, I will just pay Bitcoin for that car. Or I will pay Bitcoin for someone to mow my lawn, which sounds ridiculous right now because of what we're just going to go over a little bit. But yeah, I just don't see that to be an option yet.
Yeah, I mean, unfortunately, again, every time you spend your Bitcoin, even though, like, it doesn't make sense unless, like, you know, you're in the weeds for taxes.
Yeah.
If you got the Bitcoin for $1,000, and if you're getting a car, like, you know, 5 years later, when that Bitcoin is $20,000, IRS is going to tax you on the $19,000 of difference, because in their eyes, you created $19,000 worth of wealth, and IRS being a, you know, revenue collection agency, they want to tax it, unfortunately. So that's the law today.
There's always a way around it, and if you want to find not a way around it, if you want to find the best options, I will say, contact Sheehan. I'll put his information in the description. Sheehan, thanks so much for stopping by. I appreciate you answering these questions and taking the time.
Thank you.
All right. So thanks, Sheehan. Let's break into our second piece here. I'm going to go over these real quick. Bitcoin gets 600,000 hits on BlackRock website. So if you don't know, BlackRock, they got like 7 or 8 trillion assets under management. They're pretty big. And Lawrence Fink is a CEO. He was on the he was with Mark Carney. And he states that on his BlackRock website, Bitcoin has been the most popular subject so far. So just to reiterate, they had 600,000 hits. And I don't know the exact time frame, but whatever the time frame is, on their website, they're also tracking Chinese pandemic and monetary policy. And those were the second and third most hits that they get for their website. And it's a paltry 3,000 and 3,000. So you got number one, 600,000. Number two is Chinese pandemic, and a very close third is monetary policy. So there's a reason why they're tracking this, and it's really pretty much put up just like what Raul Powell says. He goes, look, when the CEO of BlackRock knows the exact number of website hits about Rick Ryder's interview where he mentioned Bitcoin, it shows it wasn't a mistake, but it's a test. They're monitoring this at the highest level to get involved. He knows and sees there's huge demand, and everybody knows that. It's just a matter of time before this really just blows up. And like I've always said, 2021 is the year. I think it's going to be enormous, and we'll see where it all goes. Let me know what your thoughts in the comments section. Let's move on. And then last up, I just want to do just a follow-up to this story. This was from November 30th, and it was Bitcoin miners in Chinese Yunnan province were cut off from the electricity supply. So just to reiterate, what they did was the CCP, Communist Party of China, they went to the electrical company and said, hey, if anybody is doing any kind of Bitcoin mining, shut them off right now. And they did that. So that was what happened. This was in China's fourth largest Bitcoin mining hub after some other cities that I can't even pronounce. So what we got here is another instance of, well, what happens if China, the government, cracks down on the mining pools? Remember, they're mining pools, not individual miners, mining pools. Now, here's another thing. There are individual miners that do live in China, but you have to understand these individual miners live outside. They live in South Carolina. They live in Texas. They live in the United Kingdom. They live in Canada. They live all over the world. So I don't know how many individual miners are actually living in China, but I know that the mining pools, which pool all the individual miners from all over the world, 65% of them are actually in China. So the question is, what will happen when you shut down individual miners in this region? Well, so the big thing would be the hash rate. So did the hash rate fall? If we take a look over here at blockchain.com, these are the raw values for 30 days. So this happened on November 30th. This is November 29th. This is November 30th. And then we take a little bit of a retracement here on December 1st. I don't have December 2nd or 3rd's data, but as you can see, it looks pretty much all over the place. And there wasn't like a massive, huge drop off to where everything just went to the floor. It's because this is actually good for miners, because when miners don't have so much competition, the difficulty rate adjusts. So it's not as difficult to mine Bitcoin. And if that happens, then I think maybe more Bitcoin miners will actually turn on their rigs and go, hey, it's not so difficult. Now I can actually get some Bitcoin in there. And this also gives an opportunity for other mining pools who are in wherever to actually be more competitive for Bitcoin. So it's actually good to shut down. It's like if you have like four stores and they all sell books, and then, one of the big ones like just totally shuts down, like we can't do anything. Like, great. The other three are like, fantastic, less competition for us. And it works out great. So that's what we have so far right now. But there's an article, and I'm going to get this tomorrow, because we're really going over. But it talks about, there's a U.S. Intel official, talks about we cannot allow China to dominate digital currencies. And I don't see the fear that China has with Bitcoin. I don't think that's the case. They want Bitcoin gone. They don't want to destroy it. They just want it gone. It's like a digital yuan. The big thing is CBDCs and the digital yuan to actually take precedent, because all the other countries, U.S. included, is dragging its feet. I'll go over that tomorrow. Also, if you're looking for the next cryptocurrency that's going to outperform Bitcoin, I recommend Trade the Chain. It has all the different data points that you possibly need. And what they really look at is they have a direct API into Twitter, and they parse through millions of tweets and data points and all different websites and exchanges to look for one of the nearest or the next mergers and acquisitions. When is the next listing going to happen? Any kind of negative news, like any kind of hacks. And this is a great website, but what makes it even better is the alerts that you get on your phone via the Slack app, and they come to you and tell you exactly that same information at the drop of a hat. So I definitely recommend to check that out. There's a link in the description. There's a 14-day no questions asked refund if you don't like it, just to check it out, because there's a lot of gains to be made out there, and I think this one could be great. All right, so that's it for today. So thanks for sticking with me through the whole video. I really appreciate it. If you like these types of videos, give me 2 minutes, going to pop up in your left and right. I'll let YouTube do their magic on that one. And that is all. So I will see you on the next one.